Welcome to the exciting world of HIP. This is a new departure in language instruction for English-speaking people who want to talk to and be understood by jazz musicians, hipsters, beatniks, juvenile delinquents, and the criminal fringe.
Sit back, relax, and close your eyes.
Jones.
How do I look?
Very good.
How do I look? How do I look?
Say I'm amazed. You must say I'm amazed. 5 second
rule. Cheers to all of you. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Peller Theater at the world famous Magic Castle.
Thank you all so much for being here. I also have to say thank you to the first two rows for writing random names on a piece of paper and folding them up and putting them in this box. We will get back to that later in the show. Now, my real name is actually Derek, but all my friends, they call me Hub, and I think we should be friends here tonight, and you can call me Hub as well. Deal?
Deal.
And there are some who call me Felix Jones. Mentalist. But Mr. Jones calls himself Felix Jones. Mental-ish. And already Mr. Jones knows what you are thinking. And you are correct, he does have fantastic hair.
Now here at the Magic Castle, management finds it amusing by experimenting with all of you.
By yoking together two egregiously mismatched magicians.
Who have absolutely nothing in common.
To see what happens.
But you know what, Mr. Jones, it's kind of interesting that they paired us up because it reminds me of that old movie,
Casablanca.
No, Lethal Weapon.
Oh, why?
let me explain. Look, on the one hand, you got a young kid from the streets with nothing but a deck of cards and his lightning fast wit. And on the other hand.
Oh, don't go there.
You got an old timer.
A seasoned professional.
Yeah. One who's dressed like a butler and you make people think, when really, they just want to sit back, have a few drinks, and see some real magic.
Oh, there are so many things wrong with that statement. Hub, you're rather clueless as to what it is Mr. Jones does.
Oh, I know
that
what
wasn't
you
a
do.
Question. Watch and learn. For those of us who practice mental ishity. It is our profession to plunge into the transpersonal to discover what makes each of you tick tock. Now, Mr. Jones is here not only to amuse you, but to awaken and arouse your own. You are joking!
So sorry. Excuse me, guys. Sorry, I have to take this. It's Chris.
Oh, Chris Angel again.
He won't stop calling. I'm so sorry. Excuse me, guys. Hey, Chris. Uh-huh. No, I'm not busy. What do you need this time? Uh-huh. Yeah.
All right, so where were we? Imagine, if you would, you're having a lively discussion with someone, and your cell phone rings.
Sorry.
You look at it, you see that it's your spouse, or your boyfriend, or girlfriend, you say, oh God, it's the old ball and chain. That's not a good sign you found your soulmate. Now you might ask Mr. Jones, well, where can I find my soulmate? Well, right here, naturally, at the Magic Castle. Now, unfortunately, Mr. Jones can't find all of your soulmates. So instead, he will listen from the one person whose inner voice is crying out as if in the wilderness and yearns connection. You. What's your name?
My real name? No. It's Dale.
Dale.
Yes.
Self-levitate.
Oh, God. It's easier said than done.
Come over here, Dale.
Okay.
Oh, my God. There you are. Toddle over there. There we are. So, Dale. Or whoever you are. Mr. Jones is sensing that you yearn for that soulmate. And tonight, Dale, it's your lucky night. Because you will discover the identity of your soulmate in one of these sealed envelopes. So, Dale, you will hover your hand over each one like so. And then, when one feels right, when you feel that connection, drop your hand on that envelope. That one. All right, we'll put that one aside. So Dale has chosen that one. She's found our connection here. Let's see who she's rejected. Mr. Jones' slightly elder brother, Anderson Cooper.
Phew!
Sadly, Mr. Felix Jones himself. Oh. It's all right, hitched. The life of any party, Kim Jong-un. All right, so Dale, you have rejected these three fantastic potential soulmates. Yes. Let's see who you've selected. Would you kindly read that out loud?
Oh my gosh. The gentleman wearing the fleur-de-lis tie, and his name is Raymond.
Yeah! Yeah!
So, Raymond, is Dale your soulmate?
Yes.
We have a match. Let's reward this happy couple. Thank you. Yes, it is. Yes.
Ray, will you join me on stage? Everybody, give Ray a round of applause. Come on up here, Ray. Come on, Ray. Ray, will you stand on that X right over there? Perfect. Hold on to your dollar for me. Now, Ray, thank you so much for donating this trick, this dollar to this magic trick. In return, I'd like to share with you my favorite old-time joke. Is that okay?
Yes.
All right, perfect. Let me see the dollar. I'm going to put some weird folds on it. Now, every dollar has the same thing on it. They have George Washington, the all-seeing pyramid, and they all have a bald eagle. Now that I have the dollar in this weird shape, will you hold out your hand flat for me? Perfect. We're going to set it just like that. Now, what does every eagle have?
Wings.
Yes. Will you say wing over and over and over again?
Wing, 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 wing.
Hello? High five. No, 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 stay up here, stay up here. Ray, I didn't say it was going to be a good joke, but let me explain. There's one thing on every dollar that makes it completely unique, and that's the serial number at the bottom and top here. Yes. Now remember, it was your free will to donate this dollar to this magic trick.
Yes.
And I thought it would just be inevitable that the serial number on your dollar would match the serial number that I wrote on my sign.
Oh my God.
Will you read it out loud?
J471185 44C.
A perfect match. Give Ray a round of applause. Thank you so much. You may have a seat right there. Thank you so much. No, that's your dollar to keep. When you go home tonight, give that dollar to somebody who's actually in need. And as a souvenir, you get a cardboard sign.
Thank you.
Yeah. There's also a trash can just outside.
That's amazing.
Oh, Hub, if you would, a word.
Just the one?
Now, Mr. Jones freely admits he may have accumulated a few more years worth of life's experiences, but never before has anyone attempted to misappropriate with his appurtenances.
What?
You stole my shtick.
No, no, no. Just like your little sign over there, I was only exercising my free will.
But you're the card guy. You're supposed to do card escamotage.
Escamotage in front of these people?
A card trick?
All right, we'll do a card trick.
Oh, though. It's about time, too.
Okay. Wait, where are you going, Mr. Jones?
Oh, this martini is calling.
No, 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 I just said we're going to do a card trick. You guys want to see Mr. Jones do a card trick? Come on, encourage him, come on.
Very well.
This is the oldest trick in the book.
A classic of magic.
Yeah. The way it works is they're going to pick a card and we're going to find it.
Oh, like you've never seen that done before.
It's very simple. What's your name?
Cece.
Cece, I'm going to riffle the cards down like this. Just tell me when to stop.
Stop.
Right there? Mm-hmm. Perfect. Go ahead and take a card. Mm-hmm. And you can take a card. And you can take a card.
Okay.
And you can take a card. And you can take a card. I'm just kidding. You can take a card. Look at your cards. Hey, Mr. Jones, no peeking. Look at your cards, memorize them, show them to the people behind you, the people next to you. We'll use you later.
Okay.
Remember your cards? Got it? And then whenever you're ready, will you throw your card in about right there for me? Perfect. And yours can go right there. And yours can go there. Yours there. And yours there. And throw your card wherever you like. And will you be so kind to shuffle those cards up? Cece, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yep, shuffle them up as much as you want. Now, while you shuffle those, let me explain. We're obviously going to find their cards. But we have to find their cards in a more magical way than the last person did.
Are you suggesting a duel?
Yeah, a duel of cards.
Game on.
All right. Cece, when you're ever done shuffling those cards, I'll take them back. A good shuffle. They're very shuffled. I'll help you there. Awesome. Okay, good. All right, I'm gonna keep this simple. I am the card guy, so I'm gonna keep it very simple. I'm just gonna look through the cards and try to figure out what CC's card is. Is that fair? All right, fair. CC, for the first time, nice and loud, what was your card? The Three of Hearts.
Oh, wow.
That's one for me, Mr. Jones.
Yes, that was an admirable effort. Your name would be?
Saratoga.
Saratoga, you may not be aware, but you left a psychic thumbprint on this card. If you would kindly hold up your thumb, Mr. Jones will attempt to find where it is from that fingerprint. What was your card, Saratoga?
The Five of Diamonds.
The Five of Diamonds. One for Jones.
Mr. Jones, look, I don't actually have to touch the cards either. I can put the cards away in my pocket. What's your name?
Dale.
Dale. Dale, look at me. I'm gonna reach in my pocket and pull out your card, okay? Go ahead and hold your thumb up. Apparently that's a thing. All right, I got one right out here. For the first time, nice and loud, what was your card?
Ace of Spades.
The Ace of Spades. That's two for Hub.
All right, so Mr. Jones doesn't even need to touch those nasty cards. Raymond, we've seen you here before. So Ray, instead, Mr. Jones will divine the image of your card from your mind. So let's start with the color. We have red or black.
Black.
No. No speaketh the words. Mr. Jones was going to suggest it was a bit murky and dark anyway. So we'll go with black. And now, suits would be clubs or spades. You have a rather sharp angular mind, but right now, it's going all kind of soft and puppy feet. We'll go with clubs. And now it's gonna be a court card or a number. No faces. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 2, 3, 4. Ray, your pupils dilated. What was your card?
Three of clubs.
Three of clubs.
Yeah! Don't encourage him. Don't encourage.
Two for two.
All right. What's your name?
Terry.
Terry? Yes. Terry, will you join me on stage? Give Terry a round of applause, everybody. Come on up here, Terry. Terry, look, I don't actually have to touch the cards either. You're gonna reach into my pocket, you're gonna pull out whatever card you want and hold it against your body, whichever one you want. Doesn't have to be the top or bottom one, anywhere out of the deck. You got one? Don't look at it, just hold it against your body. For the first time, nice and loud, what was your card?
Seven of diamonds.
Show him the seven of diamonds. Give Terry a round of applause. Thank you so much. You may have a seat right there. That's three for me.
What's your name?
Mark.
Mark. So Mark, Mr. Jones knew what your card was beforehand because there's an envelope taped under your chair.
So what was his card?
What was your card, Mark?
Seven of spades.
Seven of spades.
No, wait a minute. I know what's going on here. You and Mark, from the beginning of the show, were colluding against me.
Oh, for Lordy's sake. No, Mark is not a stooge. And besides, you're manipulating unconventional pasteboards.
What are pasteboards?
A deck of cards.
No, see, that's what everybody says. But this is a normal deck of cards that I get from Target.
Mr. Jones loves Target.
See, Mr. Jones, maybe you can learn a thing or two from the card guy.
Oh, but card tricks are just so... How do you call it? Jejun.
Mr. Jones, how are you going to read these people's minds if yours is so close?
Touché. Oh. Free will. Free will is defined as the ability to choose at one's own discretion. But there are times when no matter how, what, or why you choose, the outcome is inevitable. So for this demonstration, Mr. Jones does require five volunteers. Could you have the lights up, please? Five volunteers. Five volunteers. Five volunteers. You. You. The bride-to-be. Who else? We have two back here. You, sir, the lamb lover. Lamb chop lover. And, how about, we need one more. You with the pretty gold dress. So if you would come and join Mr. Jones, let's encourage them. Let's encourage them, yes. Here we have you. You'd stand here. And lovely gold sparkly thing right in between here, next to your bride-to-be, all right. So for this demonstration, you, our committee, and you, the audience, will make a series of random choices that will put free will to the test. These are the ink blots from the well-known Rorschach test, which was developed in the 1920s by psychiatrists to detect abnormal psychological function. Now, Mr. Jones has a confession. He was tested by a psychiatrist when he was only 8 years old. Yes, it's true. After an unfortunate incident on Christmas Eve, Mr. Jones's parents found it necessary to take him to see Dr. Imel Scheisshausen. Dr. Scheisshausen held up the ink blots and said, most children your age see a puppy, a kitten, a bicycle. But what do you see? Mr. Jones looked at those ink blots, and an image appeared from the mist and took shape in his mind's eye. Dr. Scheisshausen, the only thing that Mr. Jones sees in each of these ink blots is a martini. And so now, committee, you will freely choose one of these ink blots, but we don't want your choice to be influenced by any sort of a visual cue, so we'll keep them concealed. Move over just a little bit. Get you with the rest of your committee. There we are. So now use your intuitive sense and choose one and pass the rest down. Well, you didn't get much to exercise much free will, did you? No. But now you will choose whether to hold on to that ink blot or switch with anyone here.
I'll hold on to it.
Hold or switch?
Switch.
Hold or switch? Hold or switch? Hold or switch? Hold. You may now all look at your ink blot and discern which ink blot you have actually chosen. And once you've done so, show them out to the audience. Oh, so much psychosis and so little time. All right, so Mr. Jones will now interpret the meaning of each of these ink blots. So this ink blot indicates that the subject has a keen desire for change. You aspire to be the CEO of a large corporation, which you could achieve if you ever vacated your parents' basement. So cruel, so cruel. Here, have a finger puppet. This ink blot indicates that the subject has a sunny disposition and a cheerful attitude towards just about everything, which 93.2% of the population finds incredibly annoying. This ink blot indicates that the subject has an abnormal psychological aversion to women who wear black glittery things. So let's get you far away from her and come a little closer over here. Come over here. Let's just switch, get you away from her. Yeah, so this ink blot, persons who see a platypus are inclined to have a fetish for platypussi. And finally, this ink blot is known as the mother of all ink blots, and it indicates that the majority of female figures in this subject's life have indeed been women. And now, audience, it's your turn to make some choices. Sir, choose a number between 1 and 10.
I tell you?
Aloud.
Seven.
Seven. Choose a number between 7 and your age. 13 and 7 is 20. 20, we will now all count 20 together. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. Take a step forward. The rest of you have performed to Mr. Jones's satisfaction. You may now all return to your seats. Let's reward our committee. Come a little closer. What's your name?
Zoe.
Let's all review what has just transpired. Each of our committee made a series of choices about which ink blot that they would hold. Two of you made choices about what numbers to call out, which all resulted in Zoe holding this ink blot as her final choice. We just demonstrated that free will is indeed a beautiful thing, is it not?
Yes.
Yes, unless it's an illusion.
Thank you, Zoe. Let's reward Zoe. Yes.
Wow. Not bad, Zoe. It's not bad. I found something kind of interesting that we have in common. I actually saw a therapist when I was a young kid as well.
Lordy, do tell.
Well, it happened a long time ago when I was a little kid. I was walking home from school one day when a guy ran a red light and he hit me with his car and continued driving off. Yeah. And when I woke up in the hospital, I was holding on to the hubcap of that guy's car with no memory of how I got there or what happened. Now, the OC Register, I know that seems crazy, but the OC Register did write an article about me. I am from Orange County, go Ducks. The headline of the article said, "The Hubcap Kid, a Cinderella hit and run story." And I'll explain why. Because I saw everything that happened that morning, but I couldn't remember it. The memory was lost. So they sent me to a therapist who would help me regain my memory. And under hypnosis, I could start to visualize seeing that car come right at me. And right before the car was about to hit me, I was able to pause, just like in a movie, and I read the license plate on the front of the car. The therapist wrote it down, gave it to the police, and they tracked him down. And the hubcap I was holding onto in the hospital matched his car, and he went to jail for a hit and run. Thank you. And ever since then, I've been known as the Hubcap Kid, but I shortened it to Hub because that's way cooler, right?
Yeah.
So right now, I'd like to test somebody's memory because I've been really fascinated with memory. Sir, right here on the end, what's your name?
Robert,
will you join me on stage, Robert? Give Robert a round of applause, everybody. Thank you, Robert. Robert, will you just stand on that X for me? Thank you so much. Now, Robert, someone here in the audience is going to pick a card. Now, everybody gets to look at that card except for you, okay? Perfect. We'll use you right here on the front. You can stay where you're seated. I'm just going to drop cards like this, and you're going to tell me when to stop, okay?
Yeah.
Right there? Or keep going?
No.
Okay. I'm going to show everyone the card. Robert, don't peek. Don't look. Just look away. Close your eyes. Everyone got it? Good. Perfect. You can look now, Robert. Robert, in a second, I'm going to shuffle these cards face up. I don't want you to think of a card or look for a card. Just stare at the faces of them as I shuffle, okay? Got it? I'm going to do it again, because your job is to track every single card in the deck and remember the order, okay? You got that? Very enthusiastic. I like it. While you hold on to that memory of me shuffling the cards, a memory I want everybody here to remember is that from this moment on, the cards are going to be completely out of my control. And I just want to make sure you can see every single card in the deck, okay? Perfect. What was the card you saw? Was it the four of clubs?
Five.
Four or five?
Five?
Was it the five? Five of clubs, okay?
Sorry.
Robert, what you're gonna do is you're gonna, kinda like what I had to do when I was a kid. You're gonna close your eyes right now. Right now. And you're gonna replay watching me shuffle those cards face up. You're gonna see all the different cards going by, and when you spot the five of clubs, a number between 1 and 52 is gonna come into mind, and you're gonna say it out loud.
Okay, I got it, 11.
11? Okay, you can open your eyes. Did it just come to you?
Yeah.
Okay. You're going to keep me honest, and we're going to count to 11, okay? Ready? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 11 cards down. If that is, in fact, the five of clubs, that would be a freaking miracle, right, guys?
Yes. I remember it.
You remember it. You remember it. Good, let me see. We'll see how you did. Hold on to the five of clubs.
Okay.
Hopefully this works. If that is in fact the five of clubs, this entire room is going to freak out and cheer because all of that applause is for you, okay? If it isn't, though, it's 100% your fault, okay? 11 cards down, please show them the five of clubs. Give a round of applause! Robert, you're so good. Thank you so much. That's awesome. Thank you. Have a good evening.
Thank you.
But you're a strange animal. Well. Well, perhaps Mr. Jones was a little too hasty to dismiss Codrick's as juvenile.
Maybe I was a little close-minded myself to question your abilities.
Well, in the spirit of the holidays, what do you say that we extend peace on earth and goodwill towards all?
Sure. Speaking of the holidays, I got you a Christmas gift.
What?
Yeah, just for you,
oh,
Mr. Jones,
no,
while I was
you
out.
You shouldn't have.
Just for you.
Oh, but, Hub, it's so hectic this time of year, Mr. Jones, just couldn't spare a moment to find you anything.
It's okay. Go ahead and open it.
Oh, all right. Oh, just what Mr. Jones always wanted, a smaller box.
No, inside that, though, is the world's most popular toy.
The iPhone XS Plus?
No, a Rubik's Cube.
Oh, how droll. So instead of a gift, what if Mr. Jones performed a miracle of Christmas instead?
Sure.
So, on Christmas Eve, while you're gathered round the blazing Yule log with your loved ones and your family, sipping your gin toddies, perhaps you may wonder that no matter how many vanity pounds that Santa Claus manages to pack on every year, there's no chimney that cannot accommodate his ample figure in the same way that the large box just fit into the small box.
What? Wait, how's that possible? Wait, but see, that really happened and Santa Claus isn't real, though.
Oh, now that's fake news.
Mr. Jones, this isn't any Rubik's Cube. This is actually the Rubik's Cube my mom gave me for Christmas. And every morning after that, she'd mix up that Rubik's Cube and she'd put it in my lunch. So every day at lunch, I would sit there and try to solve the Rubik's Cube as quick as I could. And I would do this over and over and over again until I got relatively good at it. And I was able to solve the cube relatively fast. Now, if I came home and showed my mom that I solved the Rubik's Cube, she would reward me with a handful of Skittles.
Well, no doubt, your very clever mother figured out your little Skittle scheme soon enough.
That's exactly right. That's why she came out with a new game, a more difficult game. And that's what's on the other side of the present. What she calls the Rubik's Cube Challenge Cards. And on the faces of them are different mixed up Rubik's Cubes. Now, not only would she mix up the Rubik's Cube, but she put one of these cards into my bag. And not only did I have to solve the cube, but I had to come home and show her that it matched the cards she put in there. We played this game for many years.
Well, since none of us have actually seen it, could perhaps you demonstrate how the game plays?
Sure, why not? I haven't played in a while. Oh. Go ahead and take the cards, have someone pick one.
Over here, we haven't had you. No, let's... Saratoga. Take the cards. Find one that appeals to you. Hold that one out. Hold on to it. Mr. Jones will receive the remaining cards. Very good, thank you.
Now, the way this works is I get to look at that card for about 5 seconds. And then I have about 10 seconds to try to get this cube to match your card. So you're gonna show it to me for 5 seconds and then cover it away. Ready? Go. You can cover it, yeah. That's what happens when you sit alone at lunch every day. I'm just kidding. I had tons of friends.
Just the one.
But Mr. Jones, do you know what the Rubik's Cube was called when it was first invented?
Yes, you probably do too. It was known as the Magic Cube.
That's exactly right. And I like that name better because I'm a magician. And all I have to do is wave the card in front of the cube and it solves. And so does the card.
So, Hub, if there was a way that we could combine your talent with the cube with Mr. Jones's mentalicity, we'd be,
on America's Got Talent.
We'd have to do something really impossible. Do you have a spare cube?
Yeah, keep one over here.
All right, so, Kate, we're going to do a bit of improvisation right now. If you would skip ahead to cue, 18A, and just play it when you feel like it, and Hub, now, take off that tie. And now, Hub, we blindfold you.
What? Oh my gosh. Jeez. That was really intense. You're really good at this?
Oh yeah, Mr. Jones knows his way around a blindfold. All right, so, need some volunteer here. You who is looking away. Yes, that's what happens when you look away from Mr. Jones, he knows. What is your name?
Jen.
Jen?
Yes.
So Jen, in a moment, Mr. Jones is going to hand you this Rubik's Cube. You will select one of the 6 sides, Jen, and you will turn it one way. And then Mr. Jones will then mentally transmit your image to Hub, and he will replicate it with his.
I can't do that.
Yes, you can. So then, Jen, we go back to you.
You'll select another side, you'll turn it again, all right? And Mr. Jones will then mentally transmit that image to Hub, and he will turn your cube to match his.
Wait, wait, you've had way too many martinis. I'm not mentalist, do you not understand? I can't do this.
You can, we'll go back and forth several times until it's thoroughly mixed. Oh, but wait, there's one very important rule. You must not turn the center of the cube like so, because that's actually turning twice, and that wouldn't be fair, all right?
Okay. Good. Wait, wait, so if I heard you right, it's this
correct.
Center?
Correct, she cannot do that.
Okay, I think I
all right, so now Hub, hold the cube high above your head.
Please don't hurt me.
Oh, up, up, up. All right, Jen, here we are. Give you the cube. Oh, wait. Let's make this really diabolical. Jen, you're going to hold the cube behind your back and Mr. Jones can't even see what you're doing. Here you are. And now, Jen, hold the cube behind your back and turn one side of it. And once you've done so, say okay.
Okay.
All right, Mr. Jones will now transmit that to Hub. Hub, are you getting anything?
It's a little hazy like my IPA. Oh, gosh, right there. Okay, I'm going to guess, sir.
Jen, turn another side of the cube and say okay.
Okay.
Now we'll transmit this to Hub. Hub.
Okay.
And now Jen again and say okay. But you've done so.
Okay.
And now Hub.
Okay.
Jen.
Okay.
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 Okay. Okay. Okay. Okay, how long are we gonna do this for?
Jen, one more, stop here. Go.
Okay.
All right, so Jen, if you would now bring the cube from behind you, cover it with a hand, and if you would self-levitate and approach, come.
Can I unblindfold?
Yes, unblind yourself, please. Cover your hand, cover. Mustn't see that over here, Jen. And now, Hub, you know better than all of us. What are the odds of your cube matching Jen's?
1 in 43 quintillion. So basically not possible at all.
Unless we made a psychic connection. Unveil your cubes. Oh, well, look at that.
Oh, my God.
Yes, that side matches. And that side matches. And that side matches. And that side matches. And the bottoms match. And the tops match. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is impossible!
How'd you do it?
See, it can happen. Have faith in men.
What the heck?
Do you hear that? Hub, do you hear that? Do you know what this means?
Oh, yeah, I do.
All of your psychic sensibilities are about to climax.
If that's the case, I need to borrow some of your iPhone. Does anybody have an iPhone I can borrow? First one out, I'll borrow. Oh, perfect. Will you be so kind to unlock it? I'm not Eugene.
No, it's Chris Angel.
Ray?
Yeah.
Ray. Ray, do you mind if I go through some of your photos real quick? Is that okay?
Oh, Raymond.
Now I see why you guys
are
soulmates. Oh, my gosh.
Swipe.
Oh. You know what? Letting me go through your photos, I'm going to give you something no one's allowed to have here at the Magic Castle, and that's a selfie with Hub and Jones.
Oh, wait. Hub, the Cary Grant rule at the Magic Castle, no photos allowed.
Come on.
What the heck?
Ready? 1, 2. Perfect. Now that you have a souvenir to go home with, we're going to pull up your calculator, and as a group together, we're gonna generate a completely random number.
And to do that, we need 3 volunteers, this time randomly selected by our new bile assistant, Bunny Bill. Now, should Bunny Bill fly in your general direction, receive him. On the count of 3, 1, 2, and 3.
Oh, gotta be ready for Bunny Bill. Give me a 3-digit number, not 555 or 123. Make it really random. Yeah. 382. 382. I'm gonna hit plus. Throw bunny bill to somebody else. That was a really good thumb. Give me a three-digit number completely random from here.
Put your right foot forward, put your left foot out. Do the bunny hop.
5, 8, 3. I'm gonna hit time and throw bunny bill to somebody else. Oh, right there. Give me another three-digit number random from all there. 278. 278. I'm gonna hit equals and will you throw bunny bill back on stage? Oh! Perfect. We generated as a group together. Our number is 317. 537. And this is yours, Ray. Thank you so much.
317537. Does that have any meaning for anyone?
Anybody?
That's a lottery ticket you bought? The balance in your bank account?
I wish.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have a confession. Tonight, we have led you to believe that we are egregiously mismatched.
The truth is that we've been colluding from the start. 317.
537.
A perfect match.
But this is a two-part demonstration. As we said earlier, the first two rows, filled out pieces of paper with person's first name and put them in this box. Give them a good old martini shake, and over here, we haven't had you. Over here. Put your hand in the box. Pull one out, yes, and read that out loud. Leslie. Leslie. Well, ladies and gentlemen, from the day we were born to the day we die, we make millions of choices that have ripples of effect throughout our lives.
Now tonight, Mr. Jones and I have shown you a few examples of prestidigitation and
mentalicity. And as you self-levitate and move around the castle, do know that the source of Hobbs and Mr. Jones's powers is not us.
The source is all of you. But remember what we said about the outcomes of free will and how they are oftentimes inevitable.
Because what initially appears to be random
is actually our choice all along.
Leslie!
Thank you guys so much. My name is Hub. Give it up for Jones.
Yes, you all.
Cheers, everybody. Cheers.